Okay, hello everybody. So welcome to this additional video, which I prepared to go more deep about anatomy and how to report an X-ray. It's very important to know and remember the general principle of reporting any X-rays. Okay, just to remember, you have to read the X-ray yourself. You have to be systematic. You have to compare, observe any symmetry, and always believe you missed a finding. That is very important. Or believe you missed a finding, because that means you have to read the X-ray from around 2 or 3 times. Okay, it's very important for you. And just to remember the chest X-ray in specific chest X-ray interpretation format. So first you have to check the info on the request form. Then you have to look at the position of the X-ray. Then the evaluation technique. That means you have to evaluate inspiration, penetration, and rotation. And then you have to start to read the X-ray from outside to inside. Remember to examine soft tissues and bones first. Then extra pulmonary structures. And then you go to diaphragms, trachea, hilum, and hachados, and mediastinum. And the end, just evaluate the lung pathology. You have to remember that. The last thing you're going to look is at the lungs. Okay, it's at the lungs. It's very important for you to know that. So this is just additional video. I mean another explanation from other radiologists. So I hope you enjoy this one. And take care of yourself. We remember we are in this period of coronavirus. Okay, so bye and enjoy.
There are 5 main questions you have to ask yourself before even starting to look at the components of a chest X-ray. Whose film am I looking at? Are the patient's details correct? What film am I looking at? What view is it in? Where was this taken? Was it done in the emergency department, the X-ray department, ICU, etc.? When was it taken? Was it taken today, yesterday, last year, last month? And why was it taken? Why was it requested? Next, you should look at the aspects that affect the quality of any given chest X-ray. The rotation, are the medial ends of the clavicles equidistant from the spinous processes? Inspiration, is it adequately inspired? Are 10 to 11 posterior ribs seen in each lung field? And how is it exposed? Is it too bright, too dark, and can you see everything that you need to see? And then you're going to adopt an A, B, C, D, E approach to interpreting chest X-rays. A obviously stands for airways, so we're talking about the trachea and its branches. You're talking about the bronchi and any airways that you can see distal to that. So you're going to trace it. You're going to look down either side. You're going to look in both lung fields as well. Moving on to B, you're going to trace the lung fields. Look at the pleural spaces as well. You're going to have a look and see if the lung markings go all the way to the lateral or the side aspect of the rib cage. And you're going to make sure there's no collections in the distal portions. You're going to make sure there's no collapse of any segments of the lungs. We'll talk about segments later on in this video. But you're going to make sure there's nothing obvious in any of the lung fields that doesn't look the same as the other side. Of course, the patient can have bilateral pathology, but it's good to compare each side and contrast. For C, you're going to be looking at circulation or the cardiomediastinum. You're going to try to trace the outline of the heart. You're going to look at the right side first, tracing around the apex and then the aortic knuckle at the end. You're looking for an enlarged heart, or you're looking for a widened mediastinum. And we'll talk about some reference points for sizes of particular bits of the anatomy in a minute. Staying true to our ABCD mnemonic, we're going to look at disability next, which incorporates bones. You're going to try to trace the bones of the clavicles. You're going to look at the spinous processes that you can see in the midline. And then we're going to work on the ribs. You're going to start at the top and work your way down. You're going to start at the posterior aspect of the ribs, which is shown now. and you're going to work your way forward with each of them, looking for fractures in all of these bones or any displacement. Any fracture or displacement could imply damage to underlying structures. Lastly, E stands for exposure and everything else. So we're going to look at the skin, we're going to look at if there's any subcutaneous emphysema, which is air in the skin. We're going to look for any fragments that are in the skin. We're going to look for artifacts such as ECG leads, oxygen tubing, that could confuse your picture. You should also take this opportunity to look for any tubes that might have been inserted into the patient, such as an endotracheal tube, a nasogastric tube, or any central venous access. Now that we've had a quick run around of the X-ray, we're going to start comparing sizes of different anatomical structures. So in the diaphragm, the right diaphragm should be higher than the left, but no more than 3 centimeters. In terms of the heart, the cardiothoracic ratio should be less than 55%. And what that means is that the heart should fill up no more than 55% of the thoracic cavity. The trachea should be less than 25 millimeters across in a man and less than 21 millimeters in a woman. And if you're looking at chest X-rays, you're obviously going to be looking at the lung fields in your B part of your survey. So we're going to look at the different zones that you should be looking in. There are 2 lobes on the left and 3 lobes in the right. We're going to divide them out now. So on the right starting, we've got the right upper lobe, the right middle lobe, and the right lower lobe. And on the left, we have the left upper lobe and the left lower lobe. You can see on the right that the lobes aren't exactly a third of what you can see in the screen, and this is really important when you're trying to identify structural abnormalities or pathology. For example, where you might think is the right lower lobe is actually probably the right middle lobe, and the right lower lobe is much more lateral. This is because for most part the right lower lobe is posterior to the middle lobe. The same can be said for the left lower lobe and the left upper lobe. We're going to draw some other structures now. You can see the apex of the heart. You can see the aortic knuckle, which is the arch of the aorta as it comes off the heart. You can see the clavicles at the top there. And you can kind of see the carina, which is the bifurcation of the trachea into your right and left main bronchus. Something that sometimes catches people out is the gastric bubble, which actually is air in the stomach, and that's under the left diaphragm. We're going to be doing more videos on certain pathologies you can see on chest X-rays, because whenever you're looking at the lung fields, you should consider whether there are certain things within them. You should consider, is there any consolidation in any of the lobes that we've talked about? You should consider, are there any collapse of those lobes? You should consider, is there any pneumothorax? So is there air in the pleural cavity surrounding the lungs until the lung fields not quite go to the end? Is there a tension pneumothorax? So is the trachea shifted to the right or to the left? Is there any pleural effusion, which is a collection of fluid in the pleura which compresses in the lungs? Or is there any pulmonary edema within the actual interstitium of the lung itself?
On the orientation of the film, is it PA or AP? Often, useful information may be written on the image. In terms of image quality, ask yourself if you can see everything you need to in the picture. Then check 3 aspects using the mnemonic RIP. R is rotation. The spinous process should be at the midpoint between the medial ends of the clavicles. I is inspiration. There should be 5 to 7 ribs visible anteriorly. P is penetration, the degree to which X-rays have passed through the body. Is the spine visible behind the heart? We'll be using the ABCDE approach to chest X-ray interpretation. If there is a clear area of abnormality, don't hesitate to highlight it first, but remember to go through systematically afterwards to check you haven't missed anything. A, airway, lungs and pleura. Start with the trachea and work your way down. The trachea contains air, so it is blacker than its surroundings. Check if it is centrally positioned or deviated to one side. The trachea can be pulled towards the side of collapse or pushed away from the side of a tension pneumothorax. When describing a chest X-ray, the lungs are divided into upper, middle and lower zones. Note this does not correlate with the lung lobes. Look at each of the lung zones in turn for symmetry. Compare each zone with the opposite side. Do any areas look too black or too white? If so, decide which is the abnormal side. Make sure you can see lung markings going all the way to the edge of the chest wall. If you can see the lung edge with a black area surrounding it, suspect a pneumothorax. Note the pleura are not visible in healthy people. B, bones. Look at the ribs, clavicles, proximal end of the humerus and the thoracic spine. Check for evidence of fractures or metastatic deposits and examine the shoulder joint for signs of arthritis or dislocation. C, circulation, heart and mediastinum. Look at the size, shape and border of the heart and mediastinum. Heart size is assessed using the cardiothoracic ratio. In a PA film, the heart occupies less than 50% of the width of the thorax. A cardiothoracic ratio of greater than 50% in a PA view is abnormal and indicates cardiomegaly. Structures making up the left border of the mediastinum include the aortic knuckle, pulmonary outflow tract, left atrial appendage and left ventricle. On the right side, the border includes the superior vena cava, the right atrium and the inferior vena cava. These borders should be well defined. A blurred edge could indicate collapse or consolidation of the lung. D. Diaphragm. Each side of the diaphragm should appear as a dome with a sharp white edge against the adjacent black lung. The right hemidiaphragm is normally higher than the left by about 1 to 3 centimetres due to the liver underneath. The costophrenic angles are the areas where the diaphragm meets the ribs laterally. The cardiophrenic angle is where the heart meets the diaphragm. These angles should be clearly defined. Often, you will see the gastric air bubble under the left hemidiaphragm. E. Extra features and review areas. Look for evidence of medical intervention. For example, monitoring equipment, lines and tubes. Are they correctly positioned? If the chest X-ray appears normal so far, pay attention to the review areas. The lung apices, the hilar regions. These are made up of the bronchi and major pulmonary vessels. The left hilum is higher than the right or at the same level. They should be symmetrical in size and density. Look behind the heart, check the soft tissues, finally review under the diaphragm. In summary, this is a PA chest X-ray of Mr. Smith. The film is technically adequate. On reviewing the film, there are no obvious abnormalities. I would now like to review the patient clinically.